Great God, we have come into your house humbly to worship you, and we bring our concerns and our prayers, our praises and our thanksgivings to lay before you. Father, we ask that you open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to receive the word that you have for us today. And we ask that your Spirit would give us the energy and the enthusiasm and the drive to be better disciples in this community and in your kingdom to come. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
It's time for the children to come forward. Bring your imaginary hard hats with your imaginary light. Come on, Logan. We get to watch a cool video today. Is my light on? Yay. I'll turn it off, though, so I don't blind anybody. All right, boys. Have you ever encountered a sad time when you felt sad? Can you tell me something about it, Logan? Do you remember? Okay, Bryson. When have you been sad before?
When our dog died.
That was a sad day, wasn't it? He got old and he was sick. Yeah. Well, is there some other time, Logan, that you remember when you might have been sad? Really? Right. When it's been a long week and you haven't seen some of your family, that is kind of sad sometimes when we don't get to be with the people we love exactly when we want to. But did you know that even in our sad times, even in our darkest times, that Jesus is the light of the world? That's what Bible school is about this year, and we have a video about that. Let's watch it. Jesus is the light of the world, and we will learn more this summer at Bible school about how we can follow him and be the light to other people as well, that they may see that Jesus is the light of the world. Let's pray together. Lord, we do thank you for this day and for the glory of all that you have given to us. We pray that you would help us to find the excitement about new things to learn and fun songs to sing. And we pray that you would help us to be involved and to invite our friends and family and to start thinking about Bible school even now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our first reading this morning is Psalm 1. This is from the New Living Translation. Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers. But they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. They are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither. They prosper in all they do. But not the wicked. They are like worthless chaff scattered by the wind. They will be condemned at the time of judgment. Sinners will have no place among the godly. For the Lord watches over the path of the godly, but the path of the wicked leads to destruction. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, Fred. Thank you, John. Thank you, choir. This is a time in our worship service when we go before the throne of grace in prayer. Please notice, if you will, a box that's in your bulletin with some important information with respect to that which you see on our altar. We have on the altar the red rose remembering Jimmy Pat Thompson. Mr. Thompson, on Monday, a member of our church community, joined the church triumphant. And that is to say that in God's timing, God brought him home so that he could experience the beautiful gift of what it means to be joined again with those who have gone before him in the faith, and also to be in the unspeakably majestic and beautiful presence of his Lord and his Savior. Thanks be to God for the life of Jimmy, affectionately known as Pat Thompson. Please keep his prayers, his family, in your prayers. And let us now go before the throne of grace. Wait, I should mention the flowers. The flowers, Joan Hardwick, remembering Jim on his birthday, and Charlotte Brothers in memory of her sister, Eva Patterson. Let us pray. God of grace and love, we thank you for the wonderful privilege and blessing that we have to know that in this beautiful sanctuary, we are surrounded by dear friends and family members. And we are grateful to be known as your children. We pray with gratitude for the bond that causes us to be connected as one family, the bond of your Holy Spirit. And we lift up to you in prayer with gratitude the work that you guided of the associate pastor search team. We have been praying diligently that you would lead to us exactly the two people that you have planned for that role or those roles. And we are grateful and believing that you have brought these people to our lives. And we are grateful that how you worked through that search team to make that possible. We also want to express our prayers for those who are not with us this morning who would love to be in worship with us. There are those in our church family who are, for physical reasons, unable to be here. And we pray that they will know that they are loved and missed when they are not here, and that you will cause us to be very attentive as you work through us to let them know exactly that. And we also lift up to you in prayers of gratitude the veterans in our church family for the work that they have done as you work through them and giving us even the freedom that we have to worship in spirit and in truth without fear of persecution. We pray for the armed forces around the world. We pray for the missionaries spreading the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Almighty God, you call upon us to pray for and look out for with our care and our attention, especially those who can least care for themselves. At this time, we pray for those who are poor, impoverished, experiencing physical or emotional ailments. And we pray for those who are least able to look after themselves, the children of this world, the children that are born and those who are yet to be born. We pray that you will keep them safe and that you will raise them to love you and to know you well and to serve you mightily. And we pray that you will continually equip us to be your difference makers in Tellico Village and throughout the world. Now hear our prayer, the very prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ himself, taught us to pray together saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second reading is from John 4, verses 1 through 26, also from the New Living Translation. Jesus knew the Pharisees had heard that he was baptizing and making more disciples than John. Though Jesus himself didn't baptize them, his disciples did. So he left Judea and returned to Galilee. He had to go through Samaria on the way. Eventually, he came to the Samaritan village of Sychar, near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired from the long walk, sat wearily beside the well about noontime. Soon, a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, Please give me a drink. He was alone at the time because his disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink? Jesus replied, If you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water. But sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket, she said, and this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed? Jesus replied, Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life. Please, sir, the woman said, give me this water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I won't have to come here to get water. Go and get your husband, Jesus told her. I don't have a husband, the woman replied. Jesus said, You're right, you don't have a husband. For you have had five husbands, and you aren't even married to the man you're living with now. You certainly spoke the truth. Sir, the woman said, You must be a prophet. So tell me, why is it that you Jews insist that Jerusalem is the only place to worship? While we Samaritans claim it is here at Mount Gerizim, where our ancestors worshipped. Jesus replied, Believe me, dear woman, the time is coming when it will no longer matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship, while we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes through the Jews. But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. For God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said, I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus told her, I am the Messiah. Thanks be to God, the word of the Lord.
So here's how life works for many of us. It's something like this. We experience times when we are discontented, we lack peace in our lives, we lack purpose, we lack joy, and so we think, okay, what I need to do is I need to change my circumstances. And then when I finally changed my circumstances and moved to that new place, that new chapter in my life, then surely that will bring me the contentment and the joy and the peace and the purpose that I so yearn for in my life. And so we say to ourselves, well, you know, surely when I get through college and I get out there in the, quote, real world, then I'll experience fulfillment and I'll feel like I've really arrived and peace will be just as I always dreamed. But then it can seem like, you know, there's something that's really lacking. And I think, oh, I know, if only I can find the right spouse, then I'll know that I'll have ultimate peace and tranquility and never a problem shall I experience. And then we think, well, actually, I know if I just change occupations, you know, the occupations I've been involved with has been well and good, but I want to call that an old chapter. I want to move to a new chapter. Surely if I can just change occupations or careers, then everything will be all copacetic, if you will, in my life. But then, don't feel quite as fulfilled as we think. Surely others must feel. So we think, I know how I will reach the land of true blissfulness and joy. I will soon retire. And when I retire, everything will be a bed full of roses. And then it goes, and then it goes, and then it goes. It's true, though. We think sometimes when we're going through a time, a dry time, emotionally or spiritually or both, we think the solution is going to be, God help me, I've got to be able to change my circumstances. That's my prayer. But then sometimes we realize that ultimately there's something more, perhaps, not our circumstances, but rather that which is on the inside that is really the key to peace and joy. Anybody here ever heard of Will Rogers? Do you know the name Will Rogers? Yes, we all know that name. Well, Will Rogers on this very topic, he said, you know, when I would get restless, what I would do as I would think about, oh, I'll just move to a new town and all will be just fine, is I would, supposedly it's true, Will Rogers said it, although he was known for spinning a few yarns in his time. But he said what he would do is he would buy the newspaper, he would subscribe to the newspaper of the town to which he might be moving to make everything okay. And his subscription would last but a month. And you say, that's strange to subscribe to a new town like that. You're not even there. You haven't even decided to move there. And you're only going to subscribe for a month. He said, yes, the reason that I do it that way is it gives me just enough time to realize that the news in that town is really no better than the news in my town. And then for now, I dismiss the thought and I move along, said Will Rogers. Jesus had a conversation with a woman at a well who had a, shall we say, checkered past. Well, Will Rogers may have been as well married a few times, I'm not sure, but the lady at the well was married not once, not twice, not three, not four, but five times, we learn. And then right now in the story, the man that she is with is not even her husband. So clearly, or it appears to be the case, that the lady at the well has been spending a lifetime searching to change her circumstances in order to finally feel loved and appreciated and secure and accepted. But she's come up empty. But Jesus is there to fill her with living water. The woman at the well was a Samaritan. Now, the Samaritan was a Jewish person who was, well, the true Jewish faith people would say was not really one of their own. The Samaritans were from Samaria, but what happened was that they had chosen to marry outside of the Jewish faith. And that was seriously frowned upon by the Jews. In fact, they had also chosen to, through these relationships, become involved in other religions and basically come up with hybrid religions between the Jewish faith and other faiths. So what does all that mean? What that means is that they were seen by the Jews to be the Samaritans' social outcasts and theologically, well, following a false religion. They were seen as completely unworthy because they were not of the pure faith or the pure family line of the faith. A good Jewish person never touched or spent time with a Samaritan, for there was no good Samaritan according to the Jews at that time. So that makes it interesting for our story, because this lady at the well was a Samaritan. Now, Jesus wasn't supposed to be talking to a lady who wasn't his wife, which meant he wouldn't be supposed to be talking to a lot of women, apparently, because he wasn't married to any of them. And furthermore, it was compounded by the fact that she was a Samaritan. Now, just to show how despised the Samaritans were, this is the kind of prayer that a Pharisee would pray. Now, remember, when you hear it, or you've already read parts of it as I look at you, this is to be credited to the Pharisees, not to any other clergy people, okay? The Pharisees prayed this. I thank God that I am not a woman, Gentile or Samaritan. In other words, I thank God that I am not a woman, because Gentiles meant non-Jews, and also the fact that they would not want to pray for Samaritans because to pray for them might mean that they would be included among the saved. They did not want to even think they would see them on the other side of the veil in heaven. True hatred. And Jesus approached this lady. Now, let's pause there for just a minute. Isn't it interesting that our faith, we only speak about our faith here, we'll leave the others to their affairs, and our faith, we have allowed ourselves, many of us, to simply spend time with those who are in our immediate faith group and close friendship group. What's interesting is that we are to be followers of Jesus Christ, hence the name Christian for you and me. And Jesus, when he approached people at the party, he did not hang out with those he would like to talk football with or whatever. But rather, he went to which group of people when he would approach? He would always make a point of spending time with those who were ostracized by society. Have you noticed that? It's true throughout the scriptures. It was even true of the disciples that he put together. Many of them were hated, but he knew he could use them. So the background of this story, you have the lady at the well, and you have Jesus at the well. Now, why would it be that Jesus is there at the well and there aren't his disciples, his entourage, people might would see them? Everywhere Jesus went, most of the time at least, he was surrounded by his disciples, but they were gone. The scholars speculate that they may well have gone to get food for Jesus and for themselves. And so Jesus had walked a good ways, and he was probably hot. It was probably the middle of the day. And he asked the Samaritan lady for a drink of water. And this was a big, fat no-no. And the Samaritan woman was shocked and said, in effect, "What, me? Why would you ask for me, a Samaritan woman, to give you a drink?" Now, what we find out as the story moves in closer, we find out that it actually is that Jesus is offering to quench the thirst of the woman at the well by the water that he offers. And what kind of water is that? That water is, he calls, living water. Because Jesus knows that this woman has tried time and time again. We can only imagine. Do you think she planned her life out to where she would think, "You know what? I'm a young teenager, and one day I want to have 5 marriages and 5 divorces and find myself with a man who is not my husband." So Jesus says, knows her story, knows her heart. And so what he does is he offers her something to drink. And this living water is a way to address not her outward circumstances, but rather to fill her emotional and spiritual needs. It's been said that God has formed a God-shaped vacuum in everyone's heart that only God can fill. God has placed a God-shaped vacuum in everyone's heart that only God would fill. And so Jesus says, "You drink of my water and you will never thirst." So what does that mean to us? Jesus is saying, look, if you want to experience true emotional peace and joy, the only way to truly, in a lasting kind of way to do that, is to drink of the Holy Spirit. To commune with God. Tony Campolo, this is at least the third time that I've mentioned his name to you. That shows what I think of Tony Campolo. And by the way, I'll still say, go on the internet. I was almost said go home and get a VHS tape or whatever, but if you have one, get one. But this day and time, go on the internet and type in the name Tony Campolo, which, by the way, I did not have to do that to know how to pronounce his name this time, fortunately. But Tony Campolo, if you watch a video of him, you talk about somebody that is really enthusiastic. I'll just let you check him out and talk to me after you do. He tells a powerful story about a friend who's a pastor of a church in Brooklyn, a rundown, beat-up area of the city. And by the way, that pastor's name, or at least Campolo gives him the name, Pastor Jim. And Jim and Campolo, Dr. Campolo, got together at some gathering, and they were off to the side. And Jim said to Dr. Campolo, he said, "You know, I had something happen to me last week that I will never, ever forget. Perhaps the most meaningful event in all of my ministry." Well, naturally, Tony Campolo couldn't help but say what you would say. Well, what is that? Well, he said, here's what happened. He said, you know, in my town there, what happens is that when someone dies without a church home, then the funeral director will get on the phone and will call the different churches in the area, naturally hoping to find someone to officiate the funeral. But the man called me up, the funeral director called me up, Jim said, and he was frantic because he said no one would agree to do this funeral. And Tony heard Jim say to him, he said, I'm ashamed to even tell you why, but it's this. The man died of AIDS. No one would do the funeral, so I did the funeral. And Dr. Campolo said, well, tell me what happened. And then Pastor Jim said, well, I showed up at one of these little funeral homes, and I walked in, and there were 30 of this man's friends. And they, during my funeral, they held their heads down and they never looked up. It's as if they were counting the different pieces of wood in the floor. And I thought, this is really strange. And then he went from there, everyone got in their cars, and they went over to the cemetery. And Pastor Jim said that he stood on one side of the grave with the funeral director, and then this deceased gentleman's friends stood on the other side of the hole in the ground. And then Pastor Jim said, well, naturally, I read the scriptures and I prayed and I read the scriptures. But he said, I looked up and I noticed the same thing again. These men were stiff and motionless as statues. He said, well, then we lowered the body into the ground and I said my blessings and benediction. And then I turned to leave, and then I looked back over my shoulder. I couldn't help but wonder. And sure enough, there they were, still motionless. He said, I turned around and said, well, is there anything else that I may help you with? And for the first time, one of them looked up and said, Well, yes, I think you're supposed to read the 23rd Psalm at one of these things. Would you do that? Pastor Jim said, well, certainly. And he read from the 23rd Psalm. Another man said, well, actually, you know what really means a lot to me, and it would mean so much now, I think, to all of us? He said, would you read to us about how God loves us and how God will never, ever let us go? And then Pastor Jim read, for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And Pastor Jim said, truly, this was one of the most meaningful experiences I've ever had, and I'll tell you why, Tony Campolo. He said, I knew I was being used by the Holy Spirit to represent the church to those who largely had felt disenfranchised. And I was there to tell them, God loves you, and so do I. And so do I. What about us? Oh, we preach a gospel of grace, and we're so thankful, we say, for God's grace in our lives. But what do we do as an answer, a response to God's grace in our lives? And you know, I don't normally do it this way, but I want to take, quote, pen to paper and close with a challenge. I put myself at the front of the line. I'm being challenged. Perhaps you feel it as well, too. How did the faith community become so judgmental and condescending toward others? How did we allow ourselves to shut out those of whom we disapproved when time and time again Jesus did the exact opposite? Jesus chose to express his love on behalf of the kingdom of God, especially, not only to, but especially to those who felt disenfranchised by the society, by the community. If we truly, dear friends, embrace the grace of God, then surely we will go out of this church, and this week we will say thank you, God, by rather than judging people and looking down our noses at people, we will remind ourselves, God loves me not because I am good enough, but God loves me because I am his. And dear friend, through my actions, I want you to know. May we all say this with our actions more than our words. God loves you. And dear friend, so do I. And may God help us all. Amen.
We respond to God's word by singing together hymn number 171, What Wondrous Love Is This? Would you please stand as we sing together?
Thank you.
be seated as we continue our worship with the giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Almighty God, we present to you these, our tithes and our morning offerings. It is our prayer that through the wisdom and the mighty power of your Holy Spirit, that you will see to it that these resources are used in wise and mighty, powerful ways. That the name that is above all names, the name that is Jesus Christ, the risen Lord and Savior, may be proclaimed by all, and his healing touch, the touch of his Son, Jesus Christ, the one and only, our brother, may heal the world. In Jesus' holy name we pray, amen. Our next hymn is number 500, Just As I Am.
Thank you.
invite you to stand now as we join together in our prayer of dedication. Let us pray. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. Lord, make me, even me, an instrument of your peace. Amen.
And may the perfect grace, the perfect love, and the perfect peace of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you both now and forevermore. And all of God's people said, Amen.